I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me to give me the opportunity to present you something completely different. You probably already understood, because if you notice, I am the only one who wears a tie in this conference. I have to be weird. I'm not a molecular biologist. I'm not an expert of visualization. I am a user of visualization, but a whole different in a whole different context. Although I have to say that the two previous speakers have now introduced in a way some of the topics that I will touch in my presentation. So I would like to invite you to do a trip and to live for a moment the infinitely small of the DNA and the molecules and zoom up to this fantastic creature called the Homo sapiens. He can do amazing, he or she can do amazing things, believe me, like this guy running really fast. And visualizing the function of a human body is always being something we really wanted in science. This is a Muybridge movie, one of the first attempts of using moving pictures in scientific application to study the movement of the human body. Today, visualization techniques, scientific visualization techniques, makes possible to do very complicated things. For example, we can represent fusion. This is a fusion between MRI, CT, and motion capture data, all fused into a single representation that tells you about the biomechanics of level walking for an individual. We can visualize very large amount of data. Well, the colleague that just finished threw a gauntlet of an order of magnitude larger, so it's never enough. But this is a tissue-level micro-CT scan. It's pretty a lot of data, and today we can provide interactive visualization on a PC-class machine for this type of things. But there is a type of visualization challenge that, in my opinion, is still entirely open. And the reason for me to be here posed you a new challenge, a new territory for your research. Let me bring in something called the virtual physiological human. This initiative started around 2005. Currently, we project there are only in Europe about 2,000 researchers that are actively involved in VPH projects, and funded VPH projects. The point is this. A number of scientists coming from different subdomains of biomedical research started to realize that, first, there is no preferential scale. Contrary to what we thought for a certain amount of time, of course, there is upward causation. So what happens, the expression of the gene is going to affect the organism. But we now have plenty of evidence that is also true the opposite. So what happened to the organism is going to change the gene expression and everything in between. Even more relevant here, there are many clinically relevant processes that can only be explained as systemic interaction. If you try to describe them in a single characteristic scale, you won't be able to predict them in their entirety. Now, this poses a considerable challenge because, of course, we cannot directly observe a phenomenon that is taking place simultaneously across brutally different scales that goes from the organism down to the molecular level. So how do we do? Well, the idea behind the virtual physiological human is that you can observe sub-processes experimentally at every single scale, capture what you observe in predictive models, and then use the predictive model to represent the systemic interaction and somehow getting a clue how those things work together, even if they are at radically different time-space scales. What is the virtual physiological human? It is the framework of methods and technology that makes this approach that we call integrative research possible. So the whole VPH initiative is about developing technologies and methods that make this integrative representation possible, ideally from the atomic all up to the organism level and even beyond, representing the interaction of population and with the environment. Let me give you a concrete, specific example from my own research field. I am interested in the functional competence of the skeleton. In other words, why bone breaks under different pathologies. I cannot show you an old lady having an osteoporotic fracture, so let me show how it looks like in an in vitro experiment over a cadaveric bone. Imagine that this is a leg, your hip, you're walking along the street, and suddenly the femur gives up, and you fall down. This thing happened in Europe every year 800,000 times. There are 800,000 elders that experience this type of hip fractures. 25% of them will die in 12 months after this event for related complications. So we're talking about very, very serious clinical scenario. Believe it or not, this is a multiscale process. I will try to explain you in a moment. So we want to use multiscale modeling to try to understand better why this happened. Now, a model can tell you very stupid things. For example, one time we forgot to activate the muscles in our musculoskeletal model, and of course the prediction didn't make much physical sense. But if you do your own works, be extremely powerful to understand this systemic interaction. For example, for the osteoporotic fracture, we can use a whole organism neuromusculoskeletal model to understand how the neuromotor degradation overload the skeleton during the activity, so to predict the forces that are transmitted to the single bones. We can create an organism level model that predicts whether under those load that bone will fracture or not. We can generate a tissue scale model that will tell us how over time the disease will transform the tissue morphology, so degrading the strength of the bone. And we can realize cell tissue interaction models that describe why the different cellular population start to, in a way, destroy bone. And we can even go down to the so-called system, molecular system biology realm, and understanding what are the pathways that regulate these mechanisms because of the disease or the metabolic determinant, for example, postmenopause or hormonal imbalances, or also in relation to pharmacological treatment that might kind of improve. So all these things can be investigated experimentally alone. But the only way we have so far to understand the big picture is through simulation. The question is, can you visualize what you get from this body-to-molecule model? Well, the answer is yes and no. What you can do is to visualize every single scale. So, for example, I can build a very nice model that represents how the model, the organism model, is predicting the single muscle are activated and the forces are transmitted to the skeleton. I can visualize how every single bone is deformed by these forces, and it deforms and displays and eventually fracture. I can visualize how the models predict the cells to transform the tissue and how the tissue morphology will eventually evolve over the years because of the bone remodeling adaptation of the osteoporosis disease. But am I able to represent simultaneously something that goes from nanometer to a meter and from nanosecond to a lifetime? Well, the answer is no. So the reason I'm here is twofold. The first is to, again, throw you another gauntlet. There's a lot of gauntlets today. A challenge for your future visualization research. And the second is to tell you a little bit what preliminary attempts have been achieved in this area. First of all, why we can reasonably talk about multiscale. This is a very complicated argument, and I'm not qualified to discuss this in depth. But essentially, I'm sure you all know that essentially a visualization is There's a cognitive component of the your interpretation, but what we control is a mapping between a certain number of attributes of the data we want to display and a number of visual features. How do you choose the mapping? Well, that's the whole point, but there are certain fundamental things that you need to respect. For example, the distinguishability. Now, when you're dealing with the data I'm referring to, this mapping tends to change with space and or time, because the data and the visual feature will change over space-time, so also the mapping will. And that creates a sort of boundary. Okay. Now, with the current conventional visualization instrument that we have, so the typical monitor you might have in a normal computer, the rule of thumb in our experience is that it is reasonable to talk about multiscale visualization where this two sort of severity index on space and time exceeds, roughly speaking, 100. Might be 120, might be 80, that's not the point, but the order of magnitude is this. When you're above this, you're dealing with potentially a multiscale problem. So the first attempt we did was a few years ago in collaboration with my colleague and friend Gordon Clapworthy at the University of Bedfordshire and his co-workers as part of this European project. This is what we came out. The test problem, the exemplary problem, was a human bone scanned with a clinical CT at 1 millimeter resolution. A biopsy of the cancellous bone in the tissue scanned with a micro CT at 10 microns resolution. A further sample of one single trabeculae scanned with a nano CT at 0.1 micron resolution. This very basic application you see here proposes a certain type of interaction for objects that stay on radically different space. Essentially, the idea is that when an object goes beyond the representation level, is replaced by a glyph, in this case a very naive cube, and if you click that glyph, you're essentially zoomed to that scale. It was very nice, it was very smooth, made sense, but there's a lot of tricks hidden in this. For example, these are volumetric data that we represent with one arbitrary slice. And that's a smart trick because we are ditching the biggest problem here, which is occlusion. In reality, there were a number of limitations. So going really toward the fully 3D representation of multiscale object was far beyond. But some of the idea were laid down. In particular, I had a very interesting conversation soon after with Will Schrader, that some of you might know is the owner of Kitware, developer of BTK. And Will was working, for a completely different reason, on a concept of portals, essentially path in space, and every certain point along this path, there were this portal, and if you click them, something happened of completely different with respect to the current visualization environment. So we continued to discuss with other friends, and then we joined forces in this project that is currently running, that with a complete lack of fantasies called Multiscale Visualization Project. The people that work in this project have virtually nothing in common, including geographic location, as you can see, but they do have one thing in common. They all develop software frameworks for what I could roughly define computer-aided medicine. And all the software framework have a very strong interactive visualization component. Okay? So they are all keen of having a solution for multiscale visualization. The project is working on four goals. The first is to develop a white paper that somehow captures a sort of shared vision on multiscale visualization in biomedical application. The second is to capture a number of exemplary problems like the three CT scan that I showed you earlier in different biomedical domain, cardiovascular, neurological, and so on. The third is to try, and this is probably the most difficult, to propose some best practice for the development of multi-scale interactive visualizations. And the third is to start to develop a library, a shared implementation in open source as an extension of VTK that implements some of the fundamental building blocks for creating a multi-scale visualization. Everything has been done so far. You can find this link. Not going in too much detail, even because I'm not qualified, particularly for doing this. You probably know better than me. If you're interested, go there. Get in touch with the experts. They are very keen to have any input, in particular for people like you. So there is really a desire of sharing knowledge, because we have a feeling that we're dealing with a problem that is way bigger than us. So just a couple of notes before I show you the last demo and I conclude my presentation. In reality, multi-scale, in the way that I define it, emerged from two possible scenarios. The first is the one that my colleague before just mentioned, the so-called high-throughput imaging, where you can generate gigabyte, terabyte, petabyte of data, which end up into one unique, enormous 3D or 4D data set that, of course, you cannot display entirely. So it is a multi-scale in a way. But this type of problem, of course, comes together with another problem, which is the data I/O, because while you're doing the visualization, you also have to deal with pushing up and down terabyte of data. And the consortium is working on a number of different techniques for providing interactive visualization in essentially what are off-core data sets. Some are quite interesting, I have to say, especially for volumetric data, there are some real breakthroughs. The other thing, the other type of multi-scale data set are data set that each one has a, let's say, a resolution that is by itself representable with one single displaying environment, but there are many of them, and each is being sampled, has been captured or generated at a radically different space-time scale. And that was, for example, the example I showed you before with the three computed tomography data set. In that case, we found particularly effective the data representation that we developed in Bologna in my previous group for the MAF framework, where essentially you can organize every data set regardless of what it is. It can be a signal, volume, whatever, into a hierarchy. Every object has a pose matrix in space, position orientation, which define the position with respect to the parent object. So there is a relative pose criteria that makes possible to build very complicated hierarchy of objects positioned in space, essentially ditching the problem of registering all the data into a global framework, essentially. I would like to conclude just by showing the latest prototype that the MSV consortium produced for the same exemplary data that I showed you before, so always the three CT scans. Essentially, we modified a feature called VTK buttons that appear in the very latest version of VTK to provide this idea of portals for zooming down to further. So it is a further elaboration of the original idea we had in Bologna, but here the advantage is that these portals, for example, can be managed with respect to the occlusion. They remain in the scene even if you are zooming in. Let me, I didn't put a circular loop. So for example, when I'll go at the nanoscale, the glyph of the femur, the whole femur surface will remain in the scene, so I can zoom back, which was a big problem in the previous incarnation. You see, it's down here. there is still. So there are a few problems that have been solved. The interaction, this is real time. The interaction is still absolutely not smooth. So there's a lot of optimization to be done here. And of course, every single rendering technique will require an additional thinking and revision, and different interactors will also require an extension. So there is a lot of work to be done, but we feel the topic will become progressively more important, so probably a point where to look for the future. So thank you very much.
How far through that list are you in terms of the white papers and the and so on?
There is a draft of everything. So there is a draft by paper, there's online, everything is there, but of course it's still open for extensive discussion and revision.
From the physiological heart project, I got the impression that they are quite far, that they have a multi-scale model representation of the heart, more or less ready to use, ready to visualize. How is it with the skeletal and musculoskeletal system? In terms of models, not imaging necessarily.
Okay. In terms of modeling, the Cardiome, as it was called, was the first of the Physiom projects. So they are probably better off than anybody else. Currently, probably the spearhead is a large European consortium called EU Heart, which essentially relied on Peter Hunter, Physiom. So they continued. And I have to say that they have multi-scale model that can be personalized and is already used in quite interesting research clinical application. Mm-hmm. So musculoskeletal, we started later. So in osteoporosis, there is this VPHOP project that is doing quite a lot of things. Now there are other two projects, MySpine that is working on the spine, and MXL that is working on osteoarthritis treatment. So I think we're getting in that direction. Probably the characterization of the cardiac myocytes is still missing at the skeletal muscle at that level. I mean, we still need to do some work on that. Mm-hmm. But we're going in that direction.
Okay.
Visualization-wise, we are exactly in the same boat. We have exactly the same problems.
Thank you.
I just wondered, do you know anyone is using things like the Microsoft Kinect as an interface to these kind of data, which, you know, Microsoft Kinect has a model of the body, but it's not really a detailed scientific model. And I'm wondering if any of the people in this area of detailed scientific models are actually connecting them to things like that.
The answer is we've done nothing. But the good news is that, and this is really is a true invitation, I would like you to check on the internet something called Discipulus. This is a support action that is currently writing a research roadmap for something called the digital patient for the next framework program. So if you're working in Europe and you're looking for funding, that could be a good place where to look. The reason I'm mentioning, because one of the key elements of the digital patient will be the so-called virtual avatar. So the idea of starting to bring to the clinical user dense representation in form of avatars that can be interactively interrogated, zooming through the different scales and the different physiological subsystems.
Okay, thanks very much.